you would, and lead us in prayer as we go into the service. Ready?
All right. Heavenly Master, we just thank you for coming by this morning and awakening us to a new day. Truly a day, Lord, that you have made, and we will rejoice in each and every day that you give us. Of course, you say in your word that life is but a vapor. We're here for a minute, and we're gone. So we want to make sure that our soul is intact and where it needs to be with you, so we can make our journey to heaven when it comes our time to leave this earth. We thank you, Lord, for this church, this opportunity to gather today on Sunday. And we praise you and thank you for all your many blessings. And we ask, God, that you would just bless everyone that's here today. Bless the pastor as he brings a message. Bless the praise and worship team as they come to worship you, Lord, in praise and honor. And we give it all to you. And we praise you and thank you for your blessings on each and every one of us. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Jim. We still good, Les? Rolling? Go ahead. Let's keep going. All right, we got a few announcements. First of all, we always like to ask if we have any first-time visitors here at Emmanuel Ministry. Any first-time visitors? First time you've been here before? Anyone? Welcome. Have you guys got a card yet? They give you a card up front. Roy will get you one. Well, welcome. I'd like to be the first to welcome you. We have a card that tells a little bit about what we believe, and I'm sure you've talked to your friends there, and they probably tell you, so it'll be good. Welcome to Emmanuel Ministry, your first time here. Maybe people online, first time listening to us, so praise the Lord. They're right there, Roy. Yeah, thank you. Okay. Also, we have a few announcements here. The sanctuary is open for prayer each Sunday from 9 to 9:25 a.m. Classes for all ages follow at 9:30 each Sunday morning and again at 6:30 each Wednesday night. The men's jail ministry will be at Hart County today at 3 p.m. I know I'm going, and JT said he may not be able to make it, so if anyone can go with me, that's fine. If not, I've been before by myself. We can do it. Doesn't matter, but just see me after church, and we'll get it all worked out. So, but yeah, that's at 3 o'clock. Just remember what we're wanting there is prayer. Just pray for salvations. It seems like we're having a really good time with that. So people getting born again. Had a lady come up and tell me about a man's name that hopefully will be in there today. So it's good to pray and believe, and he wants their heart, their head, and their hands. He wants it all. So praise the Lord for that. Also, From the Abundance of the Heart, Food Bank will be open this Friday behind the Muffetville Baptist Church. Workers are needed from 8:45, that's a.m., until 2 p.m. Distributing will start around 10:30. Dress warm, because it's probably going to be chilly. A little cooler this week. All right, IMC will be the host church for the Horse Cave Ministerial Association Community Thanksgiving Service at 6:30 p.m. on Sunday. Yeah, it's actually 6:30, but if you get here early like that, just don't start without us. All right, praise the Lord. We got that. I think that's the day we have our Thanksgiving. Then we have, I think, Brother, what are we going to say here? Brother Robbie Ward will be bringing the message. And yes, so Brother Robbie, everybody probably knows Brother Robbie. He's married to my aunt, actually. So there will be fellowship meal afterwards. Our deacons will provide dishes for a regular Thanksgiving meal with the rest of us bringing desserts. See Lindsay Bird for more information. And you got with me on what we're doing on that, okay. All right, there will be a woman's activity Sunday, December the 4th at 3 p.m. in the fellowship hall. There will be door hangers to paint that can be personalized for yourself or for someone else as a gift. If you're unsure about your painting ability, someone will be there to help you. There's a sign-up sheet in the foyer. The last day to sign up is November the 27th. The cost is $30 payable either when you register or on the day of the event. Checks should be made out to Pink Daisy Market. For more information, contact Mamie Yates at, the number should be up there, 270-537-4174. Also, we are taking cash donations to help with Operation Christmas Child Ministry. A basket is in the foyer for that. And our sister said Wednesday night they had done the shoeboxes and everybody helped. And she's, the rough guesstimate right now is around 250 shoeboxes. So that's really good. She wanted to thank everyone for helping. And I think next week they'll have a little bit more on it, maybe something up here, because they have the veterans thing going on today here. So, but, yeah, that's 250 boxes. That's pretty good. Praise the Lord for that. We have a side note here. I don't believe this is up there, but it says Emily and Joey's baby is here. Now, I didn't get the name. Does anybody Titus. Oh, that's a good, I like that name. Titus. And it says when the baby gets home, they ask that if anyone does, you know, come and visit to wear a mask, please. So just be praying for Emily and Joey because we know what babies, I'd say Paula's, I didn't figure Paula would be here. She's somewhere close where the baby's at, I guarantee you that. So, well, praise the Lord for that. We're thankful for babies in the church and growing and moving on. I think that's all the announcements unless somebody's got any more.
Can I just say something real
yeah,
quick?
You
we're
go
just
going
to have another quick right after service today, all the children, we're going to practice a couple of songs. So if you can be ready for me up front as soon as service is over. Thank you.
All right. Sounds good. I remember, I don't know if anybody remembers, R.W. Shambach preaching. Remember he used to say, you don't have any problems. All you need is faith in God. So today, let's believe faith in God and things are going to happen. If you would, please stand to your feet if you can. And if you can't, we understand. Just stand on the inside. And look at that neighbor you like the best, like I said, and say, something good's going to happen to you today. I'm just going to look at everybody. Something good's going to happen to you today.
Brother DeLynn.
Yes.
I just got a message from Paula and Brad, and they asked for the church to pray for Emily and Titus. Emily's blood pressure is up, and Titus is having tremors, fever, and fast breathing.
Okay.
They won't release him, and they're wanting Emily to go ahead and stay another day instead of coming home today. And
okay.
So
thank you for that. Okay. Well, let's just do that right now, would we? Let's just all bow our heads and just come in agreement. Father, there's no time and no distance in what you said. Jesus has spoke to things and wasn't even close to it. So right now, in the name of Jesus, first and foremost, we know when the devil starts messing, God starts blessing. So we just put a blessing over them, and we speak to Emily. We speak to that body, and that body lines up with the blood pressure. We know what it's like when your blood pressure gets high, but Father, we thank you that her blood pressure is normal, 120 over 80, that her body's flowing, her blood's flowing perfectly, and her blood's flowing through her body, and it's pumping perfectly, and her heart is pumping to the rhythm of life and God's life in it. We speak to Titus, and we speak to that body in the name of Jesus, and I just pray right now in the name of Jesus that Joey has been hearing that word, and I know he knows what the word says, and I pray that man runs that off in Jesus' name. He has the right as the high priest of his home, and I pray that he gets an anointing to pray for that child and his wife, Lord, and they will come together. You said if any two agree, touching, and we're touching this ground right now, knowing that that is one of the child of God. You take your hands off of him, Satan. You have no right to him in Jesus' name. You have no right to that child and no right to Emily. They're believers, and they're a child of God. So we just thank you for it. We believe normal in Jesus' name. And all that agreed said amen and amen. Well, praise the Lord. Yeah, praise God for that. Thank God for the word. Look at your neighbor again and say, something good is going to happen to you today. Praise God. Something extra good is going to happen to you, Dennis. We'll turn it over to our praise team and let them go to work. Praise the Lord. Thank you, brother.
Amen. Good morning. Good morning. I was listening to Luke chapter 6. You know, the Pharisees were always trying to trip Jesus up on the Sabbath. He was doing some good stuff on the Sabbath. They were always trying to, they were upset by that. But Jesus said this. He said, I am in charge of the Sabbath. Amen. He's the Lord of the Sabbath. So, Lord, we just thank you for this day, and we thank you that you are in charge of the Sabbath. So we just say, have your way here today. You're in control. You're in charge. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Amen. Anybody know him? Anybody know him here? Amen. Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good. He is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and outstretched arm, his love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise. God is Isn't he good? The Bible says that his word will not return void, but it will accomplish that for which it was sent. It says that his word is forever settled in the heavens. Amen. You believe that? Luke chapter 6, verse 48 says, if you work the words into your life, hold on just a second. Back up to verse 46. Luke 6, 46. Why are you so polite with me, always saying yes, sir, and that's right, sir, but never doing a thing I tell you? These words I speak to you are not mere additions to your life, homeowner improvements to your standard of living. They are foundation words, words to build a life on. This is the Message translation, by the way. If you work the words into your life, you are like a smart carpenter who dug deep and laid the foundation of his house on bedrock. When the river burst its banks and crashed against the house, nothing could shake it. It was built to last. But if you just use my words in Bible studies and don't work them into your life, you're like a dumb carpenter who built a house but skipped the foundation. When the swollen river came crashing in, it collapsed like a house of cards. It was a total loss. Amen. So what's he talking about again? His words. He says that his words, they are foundation words, words to build a life on. Amen. Dan Moeller says this, if anybody's listened to Dan. He said, sometimes we allow our circumstances, what we experience in life, to define God and define what he says. For instance, if when we're younger, maybe we're good health, we stand on God's word about health, but then sickness comes in and we change our mind. Well, maybe God's not a healer. His word says that he's the God that heals all thy diseases. Amen. it says it's by his stripes that you were healed. Amen. Surely he carried our sicknesses and our diseases. Amen. I'm just encouraging you this morning that God's word works, and it's forever settled in the heavens. It says this, Deuteronomy. I call heaven and earth to record this day against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore choose life, that both thou and thy seed may live, that thou mayest love the Lord thy God, and that thou mayest obey his voice, and that thou mayest cleave unto him, for he is thy life and the length of thy days, that thou mayest dwell in the land which the Lord swore unto thy fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, to give to them. Amen. But I want to back up to that spot. He says, that thou mayest obey his voice. So this is Old Testament. Jesus saying the same thing, though, in the New Testament, that thou mayest obey his voice. We need to cleave to his word. Amen. Who was the gentleman, our guest speaker that we had here for revival? Jody. Remember he was talking about hold fast your confession. Remember that? Yeah. So we got to hold on to his word. Amen. He is good. God is good, and he loves people. But he wants to help us. But if we don't adhere to his word, if we don't obey his words, why does he want us to be obedient? Because he's some kind of a ruthless dictator and just trying to demand that you serve me? No, he's a loving God, and he's given us some instruction how life might go well with us. But if we obey his words, if we attend to his words. So he is good. God is good. Somebody needs to know that today. He is good, and these instructions and stuff that he gives are there because he loves you. Do not covet your neighbor's wife. Well, why? Well, it's going to be trouble. Do not covet your neighbor's goods. Why? Because now you're not satisfied with your own goods. Don't kill. Don't steal. You know, stuff like that, right? It's all good stuff because he loves us. Because he loves us, he wants us to be successful. Amen? Anybody agree? Amen. Yeah, Jesus is Lord of the Sabbath. He's Lord of today. So we just want to talk about the Lord and his goodness and his love. Amen?
Oh, throne of majesty, the Father's will complete. He reigns in victory. Sing hallelujah to the King. He is worthy to receive all the worship we can bring. Oh, sing hallelujah to the King. He is worthy to receive all the worship we can bring. What is done, what he's done, all the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven, future is heaven. I praise God for what he's done.
What he's done.
What he's done.
Oh,
what he's done.
All the glory
and all the glory and the honor to the Son.
Oh, my sins.
My sins are forgiven.
Oh,
I'll never forget what he's done. No, no, we'll never forget. I'll never forget what he's done. I'll never forget. I'll never forget. I'll never forget what he's done. What he's done. What he's done. What he's done.
All the glory, yeah.
All the glory. The Son, my sins are forgiven. Oh, my future is heaven. I praise God for what he's done.
Your future is heaven.
What he's done.
What he's done.
What he's done. Never forget what he's done.
Amen. His blood was shed for the remission of sins. It's by grace that you've been saved through faith, this not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. What he's done, what did he do for you today? Amen. Is his word true? Is his word true? Is he the God that heals all thy diseases? Amen. Is he the rescuer? Is he the savior? Amen. Do you believe it? Do you believe it? Can you act on it? Can you act on his word and act like you believe it? Amen. Amen. I sing praises to your name, oh Lord, praises to your name, oh Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be praised. And I sing praises to your name, oh Lord, praises to your name, oh Lord, For your name is great and greatly to be praised. Praises to your name. and it's greatly to be praised.
Let's lift our hands to the Lord.
I sing praises to your name.
Yes, Lord.
Oh, Lord, praises to your name. Oh, for your name is great and greatly to be praised.
Hallelujah.
Philip, I just want to pray this morning, and I don't know how to pray.
Oh.
About that's why I got you. My heart hurts, and it's so heavy for these parents. Who've lost their children to suicide. I don't know. There's been so many this past few months. And we got to come against it in young people. I know it's hard to minister to friends at school. But I just pray that God would open up our eyes. In our spirit, that if anybody around us, young or old, is struggling, to show us and give us the right words to say. Don't be scared to say something and come against whatever this is. There's nothing is too far to come back from. Nothing's hopeless. You might feel like it is, but it's not. There may be consequences to things, but nothing is hopeless. Please cry out to the Lord and we gotta come against this.
So Father, we just thank you for the name of Jesus, and our hearts goes out to those folks whose children have lost vision, just lost the vision for life and decided to go another direction. God, we pray that your comforting arm would be upon those people, and Lord, that you would give us insight, that you would give us alert us, Father, to those who are in trouble, those who have lost their way, those who are visionless, and help us, oh God, to reach out to the hurting and the dying and the crying society. And we realize that it is perilous times for the world. It's perilous times that they're in. But Lord, it should be the greatest time for us because of the light that we have to shine into the world. So help us to shine our light brighter than what we have in the past, and to help those find their way to you, Lord Jesus. And we just thank you for your comfort and arm upon them today. We can't imagine the difficulties they face and are facing, but we know that you're a good God and you will aid them and help them along the way. And again, we ask you to lead us and guide us, Lord, and give us the words and the gifts of the Spirit that we might have access and to your knowledge and your wisdom and be able to help those around us that are in trouble in these perilous times. And we thank you for it. Thank you for compassion, Lord, and making the difference. And I know Kenny loves these people and she's got a heart of gold. And I pray you would comfort her also today and give her vision of what maybe she might have a voice, something to do to help people to navigate through these times and to make a decision to stay out of those places. And I thank you for it in Jesus' name. And I bless your sister in Jesus' name. I love you. I bless you. Well, praise the Lord. Yes, ma'am.
About 5 weeks ago, some of you may know, we started the early release program here for Lee Grant Elementary School. And about 3 weeks, I didn't think I was going to have to teach that day. And in my study time the day before, the Lord gave me the word hugs. That's all he gave me, just that one word. Nancy's grinning. So that day, the teaching was going fine, but we were left with about 25 minutes. And I didn't think I was going to have to teach, and all of a sudden, they handed it over to me. And I stood there for just a minute, and I remembered a teacher when I was in nursing school, and she said, "Do you know how many hugs you have to have a day to grow?" and to stay healthy. Well, we didn't know. I'd never heard that before. So she said, okay, you have to have 12 hugs a day to grow and stay healthy. Now, how many of you have had 12 hugs today? We're a little short. So anyway, we had 10 students that day. So I asked them, how many hugs? Has anybody in here had a hug today? There was one little boy that stood up, remember, and he had had a hug. His mom had hugged him before she sent him out the door that day. I said, okay, everybody stand up. We're going to start at this end of the table, and I want you to come around, and when you get to me, you make a choice. You can have a hug, you can have a handshake, or you can say pass and just walk right on by. Now, there was two or three in there that I thought would pass. So the first one coming around is a little girl. I said little. She's a head taller than I am. And just built strong, you know? Yeah. So she comes around the end of the table, and she bear hugs me and picks me up off the floor. Well, I'm here to tell you, I was squealing, put me down, put me down. And the kids are just rolling. So anyway, she went on by, and all the kids kept coming. Everybody was getting a hug. And this one little girl, I thought, well, this is going to be the one. She stood there for a minute and looked at me, and then she bear hugged me. Every week, I asked them, what's the first question I'm going to ask you today? And one of them will say, did we bring our Bibles? I said, well, that's a good question, did you? And then the next question is, well, what's the next question? Did we get any hugs today? So every week when we start that class, the first thing we do is stand those kids up and bring them around to hug them. Now when I go to the ball games, they come to me for a hug. Parents, put your phones down. Put your computers off. Start spending time with your kids. And if you can't have a conversation, have a bear hug. That's what they're missing. It's the love and the communication with their parents. And if they can't get that from you, they're going to find some other place, or they're going to become hopeless, helpless, and fall to suicide. And that's not where God wants those babies. This is our future. This is the future of the church, the future of our country. My goodness, we've got to get it together. Hug a child today. If it's not your child, hug them anyway. Ask Connor. He's standing over there about 6'2 or 3, and I don't let a time go by when I see him that I don't make him bend over so I can hug him. God bless you.
So this morning, as we take up our offering and you come around, hug somebody. Find somebody you can give them a hug this morning. If you really, 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 really don't want to be hugged, well, deal with it. That's all I know to say. Every praise is to our God. Come and worship Him this morning. Hallelujah. All right, you trio, I want y'all to sing out here this morning. Every praise to our God, and every word of worship with one accord. Every praise, every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah, glory, glory, hallelujah. Oh, every praise, every praise is to our God. Every praise to our God, and every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah, oh glory, hallelujah, oh every praise, every praise is to our God. Oh,
to our God, and every word of worship with one accord, every praise, every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah, oh glory, hallelujah, oh, 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 every praise, every praise is to our God. God my Savior, God my Savior, God my healer, God my deliverer. Yes, He is. Yes, He is. God my Savior, God my healer, God my deliverer. Yes, He is. Yes, He is. God my Savior, God my healer, God my deliverer. Yes, He is. 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 And every praise to our God, and every word of worship with one accord, every praise, 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 every praise is to our God. Amen. 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 Praise the Lord. Come on in. Brother and sister, praise the Lord. The Lord is good and His mercies endureth forever. Praise the Lord. Now, Karen, tell me how much the postage is to ship one of those boxes. $10 a box. Well, in my lightning fast mind, 250 times 10 is just only $2,500. That's all it is. So if somebody wants to just pay the postage this morning, they can leave it out there. Okay. All right. Praise the Lord. Discipleship program? I don't know. $6 for discipleship. They got a discipleship program? Okay. I didn't know anything about that. Okay. That's for the people that's getting the boxes or what? What's this? Okay. Cool. Over 4 billion took the discipleship class. Wow. That's awesome. That's awesome. Amen. Brother, would. Amen. That's good. Over 2 million received Christ. That's awesome.
Pray with me. Dear Lord, we thank You for this day, and we thank You for just gathering us together here today just to praise Your name. Lord, we speak Your name over suicide, over depression, fear, and anxiety. We speak Your name over anything that's holding us back. We pray that You just help us let go of all those things and ask help. We thank You for Your protection. We pray that You just keep being with us, Lord, and amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. You can be seated. We have a special program this morning for our veterans, and Lindsay's coming to lead that program with us today. We certainly do thank the Lord for all our veterans, not only those that's here, but those that's around the world. Because of them, we're safe and sound here today. Amen. And we thank God. Amen.
Thank you. We're going to start with a video. You go ahead, Dale. Amen, amen. Okay, so welcome. Hello, I'm Lindsay. Do a few things around here. We want to take this time to honor our veterans that we have in the room. I was looking some things up to make sure that I did this correctly. Don't want to dishonor, not even for 1 second, one veteran in this room, let alone one in this country. And I did some research, and there are 16.5 million military veterans in the U.S. as of last year. That is a lot of people. It's a lot of people. I wanted to, last year we actually showed a video. These videos honestly say it better than I ever could, but the next video that we're going to show is one that is super educational. You may remember it from last year. We did show it. If I'm in charge, we'll show it every year because it is absolutely empowering. It causes you to think outside of your box. And after this video, I am going to bring up, if you are a veteran of any branch and you're in this room, I would ask you to come up after this video, and we're going to present a card from us, which is such a small thing to give you. I wish I could, like, give you a car, or I just don't even know what, like, it's, I just feel so, I don't know, I was super humbled just, yeah, this weekend, just super humbled. Actually, when I was younger, I had something in me that told me to go into the military, and I was like, oh gosh, that's so big. So I did research, and I'm a very determined person. I love grit, and I love, you know, responsibility and just doing the right thing. I love people, and I love our country, and I love the Lord. And I thought, oh man, what a great place to serve and do what God's called me to do. And just before going to actually take steps to see a recruiter and all that, I just had such a stop in me to not go. But I just have had, I've always had such a heart for veterans and just anybody who takes their time. Something I thought about this weekend too that I wanted to share is most of you chose to do what you did before you even had children, right? Right? Most, you didn't have children, right, yet? So I personally, as a mother, I could see myself being more like, yes, I want to fight for this country because I see my offspring coming up and I want to make the country better for them. But to make that decision before I bring offspring into this world, that's, to me, that is so honorable that you would choose to fight for a country. And I know there are a bunch in this room that don't have children yet, but once you have children, it's like you cross this line. You're on another side of the world. It's totally different. You think different. You view things differently. But for you to view it on this side and still say yes to do that is so honoring. And I'm personally so grateful. And I know Emmanuel Ministry has always been extremely great about putting our veterans first and trying to do whatever we can do to help any around us, any in the room. Just super grateful. So we're going to play this, and then we'll have you come up if you don't mind, okay? Go ahead, Dale.
There was a lawyer once. His name was Francis Scott Key. He penned a song that I'm sure you're aware of. You've seen it. It's in most hymnals throughout our churches. It's called the National Anthem. It is our song as an American. We go, however, to a ball game. We stand in our church services, and we sing the words of that song, and they float over our minds and our lips, and we don't even realize what we're singing. Most of us have memorized it as a child, but we've never really thought about what it means. Let me tell you a story. Francis Scott Key was a lawyer in Baltimore. The colonies were engaged in vicious conflict with the mother country, Britain. Because of this conflict and the protractedness of it, they had accumulated prisoners on both sides. The American colonies had prisoners and the British had prisoners. and the American government initiated a move. They went to the British and they said, let us negotiate for the release of these prisoners. They said, we want to send a man out to discuss this with you. They were holding the American prisoners in boats about 1,000 yards offshore. And they said, we want to send a man by the name of Francis Scott Key. He will come out and negotiate to see if we can make a mutual exchange. On the appointed day, in a rowboat, he went out to this boat and he negotiated with the British officials. And they reached a conclusion that men could be exchanged on a one-for-one basis. Francis Scott Key, jubilant with the fact that he'd been successful, went down below in the boats, and what he found was a cargo hold full of humanity, men. And he said, men, I've got news for you tonight. You're free. He said, tonight I have negotiated successfully your return to the colonies. He said, you'll be taken out of this boat, out of this filth, out of your chains. As he went back up on board to arrange for their passage to the shore, the admiral came and he said, we have a slight problem. He said, we will still honor our commitment to release these men, but it'll be merely academic after tonight. It won't matter. And Francis Scott Key said, what do you mean? He said, well, Mr. Key, he said, tonight we have laid an ultimatum upon the colonies. Your people will either capitulate and lay down the colors of that flag that you think so much of, or you see that fort right over there, Fort Henry? He said, we're going to remove it from the face of the earth. He said, how are you going to do that? He said, if you will, scan the horizon of the sea. And as he looked, he could see hundreds of little dots. And he said, that's the entire British war fleet. He said, all of the gunpowder, all of the armament is being called upon to demolish that fort. It will be here within striking distance in a matter of about 2.5 hours. He said, the war is over. These men would be free anyway. He said, you can't shell that fort. He said, that's a large fort. He said, it's full of women and children. He says, it's predominantly not a military fort. He said, don't worry about it. They said, we've left them a way out. And he said, what's that? He said, do you see that flag way up on the rampart? He said, we have told them that if they will lower that flag, the shelling will stop immediately. And we'll know that they've surrendered, and you'll now be under British rule. Francis Scott Key went down below and told the men what was about to happen. And they said, how many ships? He said, hundreds. The ships got closer. Francis Scott Key went back up on top and he said, men, I'll shout down to you what's going on as we watch. As twilight began to fall, and as the haze hung over the ocean as it does at sunset, suddenly the British war fleet unleashed. He says, the sound was deafening. There were so many guns that there were no reliefs. He said, it was absolutely impossible to talk or hear. He said, suddenly the sky, although dark, was suddenly lit. And he says, from down below, all he could hear the men, the prisoners, saying was, tell us where the flag is. What have they done with the flag? Is the flag still flying over the rampart? Tell us. 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours into the shelling. Every time the bomb would explode and it would be close to the flag, they could see the flag in the illuminated red glare of that bomb. And Francis Scott Key would report down to the men below, it's still up. It's not down. The admiral came and he said, your people are insane. He said, what's the matter with them? He said, don't they understand this is an impossible situation? Francis Scott Key said he remembered what George Washington had said. He said, the thing that sets the American Christian apart from all other people in the world is he will die on his feet before he'll live on his knees. The admiral said, we have now instructed all of the guns to focus on the rampart to take that flag down. He said, we don't understand something. Our reconnaissance tells us that that flag has been hit directly again and again and again, and yet it's still flying. We don't understand that. But he said, now we're about to bring every gun for the next 3 hours to bear on that point. Francis Scott Key said the barrage was unmerciful. All that he could hear was the men down below praying. The prayer. God, keep that flag flying where we last saw it. Sunrise came. He said there was a heavy mist hanging over the land, but the rampart was tall enough. There stood the flag, completely nondescript, in shreds. The flagpole itself was at a crazy angle, but the flag was still at the top. Francis Scott Key went aboard and immediately went into Fort Henry to see what had happened. And what he found had happened was that that flagpole and that flag had suffered repetitious direct hits. And when hit had fallen, but men, fathers, who knew what it meant for that flag to be on the ground, although knowing that all of the British guns were trained on it, walked over and held it up humanly until they died. Their bodies were removed and others took their place. Francis Scott Key said what held that flagpole in place at that unusual angle were patriots' bodies. He penned the song, "Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming? Or the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that the flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet fly and wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?" The debt was demanded. The price, it was paid.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and does that star spangled
doesn't do it for you, you got something going on, because that should absolutely make you want to just, for one, hug a veteran, for two, love your country, be positive about the red, white, and blue, right? I mean, is everything perfect? No, but the original foundation and what was created for us to carry on, it was perfect, and that's our job, right? So what you say, what you teach your children to say about our flag, and you know, just respecting that, and making sure that they respect that. And the best way to teach them how to respect that is for you to do it yourself. Okay, so veterans, if you don't mind, I know we have several that aren't here today, but if you would come forward, I would love for you to receive this card and let us know your branch, your rank, how long you served, things like that. Yeah. Yeah, great. Yes, yeah, Mary can come up for Herb. Yes. Yeah, or if you're a spouse of a veteran that is still living, we would like for you to come up as well. If you don't mind, I would like for you to share your branch, your rank. If you do, you know that for Herb? Okay.
He was in the Army for 2 years and Marines for 4 years.
U.S. Army, 25th Infantry. I was an E4.
United States Army, 101st Airborne. I was in the Army for 69 to 73. E3.
United States Marine Corps. I served in the 1st, 2nd, and 3rd Aircraft Wing and served in Vietnam.
Thank you, sir. United States Marine Corps. I served from 98 to 06. One tour in Bagram, Afghanistan, Air Wing as well.
Tell them your name.
My name is Brooke Morris, and my beautiful wife, Bethany Morris, my two kids, Rhett and Reed, and then my brother and his wife are from out of town, so we appreciate being here.
Thank you for coming.
100%.
Thank you for serving.
Thank you. My pleasure.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. What? Got one more to talk? Okay.
Yes, no, I was
going
to say, if you all have anything to say, I want you to say it. Okay. Yes, please.
You know, when I watched that presentation of the Star Spangled Banner, I couldn't keep from crying, thinking about those men that loved America and wanted to establish us as a free country, a free nation. And I look at all the wars that these men have served in, and they went out there willing and knowing that they could lose their lives so that we could stand and say, we'll never give up. We'll never give in. We'll never give out. And now we raise a standard even higher than our flag, and that be Jesus Christ our Lord. We'll never lose. We're always conquering, conquering. We're more than victorious.
I don't know if you know this, but suicide, we've talked about that 2 weeks in a row, but every day 22 veterans die of suicide. And I think it's that some of these young men lose their vision, right? They're together, they have a vision that's bigger than them, and all of a sudden, it's gone. And we as a country have lost our vision as well, I think. But there's a verse that I try to live by that kind of speaks to it, and it's 2 Samuel 10:12. Be strong, let us fight bravely for our people and the cities of our God, and the Lord will do what is good in his sight.
I guess I'm kind of partial to Vietnam War. I was thinking last night, I got a cup at the house and it said like 58,000 plus lost their lives over there. And then the ones, even the ones that came back, they suffered bad things and lost their lives. Just, and my cup says, never forget. And I'll never forget. I'll never forget what they've done for us. Oh, Lord, I'm telling you what, it's something else. I know people seen shows about Vietnam, but it ain't nothing what happened, really happened over there. But just don't ever forget an American soldier, because, you know, a soldier does what they tell him to do. Now, it might not always be right in the eyes of anybody else, but if he say, if they say go here and do this, well, you got to do what you got to do. And but I know it's tough, but always remember, and a veteran went to war for our country, for each other of us, for you, and it's just keep them uplifted, keep them in your heart. Thank you.
I was blessed when I was in, nothing went on. I've got a son that was in, as this gentleman said, we have to think about the suicides of these men. My son is fighting things that I don't see. Nobody sees. It's in him. He was deployed over 6 times. That's way too many. We got to get busy with these veterans that have been over too many times. They are needing the help. We need to remember them. I don't talk much. I'm done.
Yes. Thank you, gentlemen. God bless. Got one more song to play.
If tomorrow all the things were gone, I'd work for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom and they can't take that. To the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA, where there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say,
praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Thank God for the American soldier. Lindsay, is this your phone here? Yes, praise the Lord. Well, as Brother Sammy said, that the only greater one is the Lord Jesus Christ, who died for all of us that we might have eternal life. And what a waste it would be for Jesus Christ to have come and lived and suffered and bled and died and went to the place of torment for us, and then we refused him. We rejected him. It'd be one thing to not stand for the flag, and I don't know about you, it just irks me that anybody would not stand for the flag. I don't care what kind of sportsman you are, or I just beyond me that we could tolerate such stuff. I don't like to burn American flag. I know that maybe that's the proper way to get rid of them once they get to a certain place, but that's one thing. But to burn one out of disrespect, I'd have a hard time with that. but there's the Lord Jesus Christ is definitely who we stand for here today, and the American soldier and men and women as well. Father, today we're so grateful for all that you've done for us through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And we thank you that this America, the United States of America, was built and founded upon your principles and the real principles of sacrifice of your Son, of you. We patterned this nation to be servants and to give ourselves to serve. And even if it cost our life, millions have served you in such capacities down through the days and the years. And we thank you for each of them, O God. And we thank you so much for Jesus. Thank you, thank you, thank you for paying a price that we could not pay. It was not within our ability to do that, and you did that for us. So today we want to thank you, we want to honor you and respect you and do the right thing that we should do in respect to your Son, Jesus Christ. I ask you for utterance in the Holy Ghost. I might say something here in these few minutes that would be beneficial to these people, and that we would just honor you as we come to the table of the Lord and receive of the bounty that you have laid before us through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. Thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. If you turn in your Bible just for a moment, I know when it says a moment, that could be people that rest or tell me just a second, and I know what that means. In the second Peter, the book of Second Peter, if you will, I was reminded of the time when the granddad had his little child with him, a grandson with him that wasn't raised in church, and they were in the foyer waiting for the service to be done, and he had been to church a time or two, and they was out there looking around and found a bulletin board like we've got of soldier men and women that served, and so they were looking at that, and he said, "Papa," said, what's that?" He said, "Oh," said, "those are people who died in the service." And he eyes kind of bugged, and he swallowed real deep. He said, "The early service or the second service?" So, so we hope you don't pass out in the second service here this morning. But it can seem like that sometime, I guess. In the book of 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 12, "Wherefore I shall not be negligent to put you in, to put you always in remembrance of those things, though you know them and are established in the present truth. Yea, I think it fitting, as long as I'm in this tabernacle, to stir you up by putting you in remembrance." So that's what we do on Memorial Day, our Veterans Day. We take a time to remember and respect those who have given the sacrifice they've given. And then we here every Sunday, we do the same thing. We come together and worship God and thank God. And it's my job to put you in remembrance, though you've probably been taught these things. How many of you know if you don't continue to look into the Word of God and kind of read and look around, that some things just seem to slip your memory, you know? And it's very good to be reminded, isn't it? And that's part of the job that I have, is to put you in remembrance, that you know that our victory is found in Jesus Christ and in Him alone. To be honest with you, the victory we're looking for here today and the victory as America, I think, is found in Jesus Christ. I think our America needs to get back to the Bible, needs to get back to Christ, because the only real victory is in Him, because in Him we what? Live, move, and what? Find our being. I mean, that is a motto that you and I, as Christians, we need to absolutely have. Let's put that up there, Dale, Acts 17:28. This is something that we ought to just have automatic in our hearts and in our mouths. Is in Him we live, in Him we move, in Him we find our being. And if you try to find it somewhere else, you're going to miss it. Amen. Amen. It's just nobody else really has it. I mean, there's some people that's done well, no doubt, but it's only in Him. Amen. For in Him we move, and for we are what? His offspring. The next scripture, put that up there. "For as much then as we are the offspring of God." That's who we are. We're Christians. We're not trying to be. Amen. I was born a Christian. I mean, I'm not trying to be a Trent. I was born a Trent. It's just in me, right? In the same way with Christianity, if it's not born into you, you can't hardly just study it. And to just discipline, you can't discipline the heart of God into your spirit. You can bring your flesh under control, and we appreciate that. We really do. But in order for it to work right, you've got to be born again. Yes, must be. Isn't that right? I mean, Jesus said it Him own self, you must be born again. And then when you're born again, our goal, our agenda, is to abide in Him. John chapter 15, about verse 6, 7, and 8, to abide in Him. So if we're born in Him, born of Him, and then we abide in Him, and His Word abides in us. Victory. Victory is in Him. For as much as, okay, still up there. "If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch, and is withered, and men gather them and cast them into a fire, and they're burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you." Listen, that's the goal. Amen. That is our goal. We live, move, and find our being in Him, and we abide in Him. just like an apple, if it's going to get to the perfect ripeness, it needs to stay on the tree, don't it? Those apples that gets blown off early, you try to eat one of them and it'll lock your jaws. I'm telling you. I mean, you can't even fry them and eat them. It's got to come to a point they have to develop some before they're even good to fry and eat. But the longer they're on that tree, just before they rot, they're just right. Amen. What's mellow mean? People said, my brother used to sing, and he said, had a fellow to tell him, so that you got a mellow voice. And he said, I thought that was really good until I looked it up, and it says almost rotten. Right to almost rotten, you got a mellow voice. So I wasn't sure about that now. But we need to abide in him, do we not? And that's where our victory is, and the devil is going to try his best to disconnect you from God. And that's exactly what he did in the garden. Adam and Eve were walking with God. Everything they needed was in the garden. They had no shortage of any kind. And he plotted a plan to get them disconnected from God by doing what? Eating of the forbidden fruit. The one thing they wasn't supposed to eat of, he challenged them. He said, oh, you just don't know life until you do this. And the devil's still using that same old 6 and 7 today, trying to get people to do something they shouldn't do by thinking that there's something out there that God's withholding from them. No, God knows the best for you. And if we'll listen to God, we'll have the best. Amen. We can have you can be the very best you by listening to God and letting him lead you and guide you and direct you. And as you abide in him and his word abides in you, you can ask what you will. See, your desires change. If you'll give your heart to God, he can give you your heart's desires. But if you got these desires that's wrong, and then you're going to give your heart to God to get those desires that's wrong, it ain't going to work. Though the Bible says God will give you your heart's desires, what that means is you'll give your heart to God, he'll put the right desires in your heart. Amen. He'll give you the right desires so that you'll live your life in his plan, in his purpose, after his will. And you can abide in him, and he'll abide in you, and you won't miss nothing. Everything will be perfect. You think you're in the paradise of God because you'll be asking according to his will. Amen. Isn't God good? He's good all the time. So I want to put you in remembrance. If you'll back up here a few verses over here in that 2 Peter chapter 1 and look at verse 2, and we'll look at a couple, 3 verses here, and we'll let you go. Grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Isn't that awesome? According as his divine power hath granted or given unto us all things pertaining to life and godliness. We use a term, you've already got it before you ask for it. Well, we understand that if you're dealing with an infirmity, for me to just tell you you've already got your healing, move on. Well, that don't seem to release you of the infirmity. You know, that can make you feel kind of silly. Why are you telling me that if I've already got it and here I am in the middle of it? Well, the promise of God's victory for you is sealed by the blood of Jesus Christ. God has already purchased your redemption. He's already purchased your healing. He's already purchased and he's got it wrapped up for you. It belongs to you. And you can come to God and receive it. You can believe, you receive, and you shall have it. Just like we say, well, everybody in the world's already saved. Well, we could fold up our Bible and shut the buildings up, make corn cribs out of them. No, everybody's already saved because Jesus paid the price for everybody, but there's a world of people that ain't saved because they never heard the message and believed. Amen. So we're to go tell them the truth and get them to believe the report of the Lord. Amen. So that's what our goal is to get people to believe in that Jesus Christ is the healer, and healing belongs to all who come to Christ. All who are born again and receive Jesus as their personal Savior, health and healing and deliverance and wholeness belongs to every single one of us because we're in the family, and that's part of the, when you read the will, it's in the will. This is a copy of the last will and testament of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So you don't have to argue with me. Don't argue with me about it. Tell the devil, get his hands off what belongs to you. I ain't holding nothing back from you, right? I'm not your problem. I'm trying to be your helper here today. So I don't want to I want you to be negligent. Because every promise, everything pertaining to life and godliness, I want you to know it's already given to you. And it's made available to you by faith through the knowledge of Him that hath called us unto glory and virtue, by which are given unto us exceedingly great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of this divine nature. It belongs to you. It's in your spirit, man. When you got born again, every single thing that God had for you was squares into your spirit. It was inserted into your spirit, man. Amen. You can draw it up. Amen. I'm not saying you're God or nothing like that, but I'm saying it in your spirit. Now, when a born-again child of God dies, when he's deceased, you peel off the peeling, and there he is, right? Many times the flesh, the peeling on the outside, is not reflecting what's on the inside. With the resistance has been put up. And the flesh wants to do what outside the world says to do. But no, we're trying to get you to understand your best life, if you're a born-again child of God, your best life is inside of you. It's within you. Greater is he that's where? In you than he that's in the world. Your best you is in the Christ inside of you. Though there's a battle that goes on out here in this world. And the battle goes on in our mind, warring in our mind. The decision of who I'm going to serve comes down to my thinking. Comes down to my mental assent. Am I going to choose to serve God? I choose to serve the world and the flesh. And it's a powerful choice, no doubt about it. No doubt about it. Many serve God for a while, and then they wander off into la-la land, and they go through all kinds of stuff, terrible. But it happens. It doesn't mean they're not Christians. It just means they're not following Christ in their world, in their life. They're following somebody else. And it hurts. It breaks your heart. As a parent or grandparent or a church member, to see those decisions being made. So we pray for them. We pray that their landing won't be so bad, because what you sow, you're going to grow. And you know they're out there sowing seed and making decisions that the end thereof ain't going to be good for them. So you pray that there's a pillar somewhere when they fall. You know, that they don't fall on concrete, because they're going to fall. Right? I mean, it's just going to happen, and you can pray and cry all you want to, Mom and Daddy. You just got to hope and pray that their fall gets broken by something. And they come to their senses, and they repent of their sin, and they get back into the good graces of God. Amen. But when it's all said and done, if they're a born-again child of God, washed in the blood of Jesus Christ, the spirit man would be all right. I believe that. You say you sound like a Baptist. No, I sound like a Christian. Amen. It's just a Christian, just the Bible. And I praise God. I mean, I preached a young man's funeral that he made a bad decision and got killed. And I preached his funeral. And I preached it on the basis of a decision that his parents made back many, many, many years ago. His parents made the decision to take this boy to a revival. Well, that was a good decision, because he came to Christ in that revival. Over 100 years before that date, some people made a decision in the community to get together and pray. That was a good decision. And out of that decision, there was a word that came from the Lord, and they obeyed it to start this church that had this revival that this boy got saved in. Decisions. Decisions, choices. Over about 40 years ago, a bunch of us were praying, close to 50 years ago, I guess. And, you know, it was put within the hearts for us to have a church, a work of the Lord. And various things happened, things, some went this way and some went that way. But the Lord called me to go to Rhema, and I went in 1984. Soon be, what, 40 years? Man, that's a long time ago, ain't it? Anyhow, decision was made. And the choice was made. The Spirit of God put within our heart to come back here and start a work. Other people had heard the same thing. And we began nearly 40 years ago in the old rented building across the road here that my mom and dad owned. Wasn't long till we bought that. We made a decision. It's a product of decisions. Many decisions are led forth by the Spirit of God. And those decisions will bring you forth on a pattern to reach the goal and the destiny that God has for you. And I really believe we're on the goal, the destiny that God has for this church. I believe we're going to see our greatest empowering and outpouring of the Spirit yet. We have not by any means got to the pinnacle. Amen. We're still laying foundational things. We're still building on things. And we're still inviting you to get involved with us because I believe our greatest days are ahead of us. Amen. I really do believe there'll be a sweeping revival through this region here that's going to produce a lot of good things for the Lord. I really do believe that. And we're trying our best and doing the best we know day by day to stay in that pattern, to live under that. And, you know, we know not the time of our departure. And that's what this guy was saying. I know not the time of my departure. I don't know. But as long as I'm here, I'm going to put you in remembrance of these things. We're here as a product of choices. You're here today as a product of your choice or the choice of your parent. You may have been drugged today. You may be on drugs right now. They may have drugged you in this church. But somebody made a choice to get you here. And we're all product of choices, right? So while you're here today, the Spirit of God is knocking on your heart's door. I wish you would choose to let Jesus in. That's a choice you make. Nobody else can make that choice for you. They can drag you to the altar, but they can't make you choose Jesus. That's your choice. God made a choice to love you enough to send him to pay the price that you could not pay. A price that was really over your head. That God loved you enough to pay it for you. And he asked you today, will you receive him? Will you accept what Jesus Christ has done for you? Will you receive him as your personal Savior? Will you receive him as your Lord? Will you pattern your life after his example? I put you in remembrance that we're called to follow Jesus. We're called to live holy lives. Be ye holy as I'm holy, saith the Lord. We're called to live a life of holiness. I'm not talking about wear clothes of holiness. I'm talking about living lives of holiness. Amen? And there is a difference. I put you in remembrance of these things today as our eyes are closed before the Lord this morning. Father, I reminded the people today of the great sacrifice that you made for them, a choice that you made to love them and to die for them so that they could spend their eternity with you. Now, Lord, I ask you to effect their purpose, to knock on their heart's door, that they would choose to receive what you've done for them in your death and in your burial and in your resurrection, that they might have eternal life. I lay it before them and I lay it before you. Knock on their heart's door, I pray, Father, if there's one here today. that doesn't know Jesus, that hasn't experienced the born again experience, I pray that you would draw that one unto yourself today. And I thank you for it. With every head bowed and every eye closed, is the Lord knocking on your heart's door today? What do you mean by that, preacher? Is there something going on inside of your heart, inside your spirit? You feel something going on in you that you know something's up. If you feel that drawing of that loving of God, that wooing of God, it's just simple God telling you that I love you and I want a relationship with you. I want you to be my child, my son or my daughter. If you're not a born-again child of God and the Lord is dealing in your heart today, would you simply raise your hand and say, pray for me today, preacher? God bless you, sir. If you're here today and the Lord is dealing in your heart, would you come to this altar and say, Lord, I want you to come into my heart. I want to be your child. I want to be your son. I want to be your daughter. I want to live for you. I want to serve you and to honor you. Would you be bold enough to come to this altar under that invitation today? I will serve you, God. I will honor you, God. I will live for you. Come into my life and change me today. God bless you, sir. The Lord is good and his mercy endureth forever. Amen. Praise the Lord. This young man right here, God bless you, sir. This young man right here, will take you aside back here, Travis, in this room, and y'all talk this over. Let's pray for him as he goes. Father, I thank you for drawing him to this altar today. I know not what's going on in his heart or life, but I pray, Father, that you would lead Brother Travis, that you give him insight of what to say to help this young man find that place where he needs to be with you today. I pray, Father, that you would fill him with the Holy Ghost and power and give him a vision, give him a heart of understanding, that he would know your will and he'd be able to resist the enemy and this world system and live for you all the days of his life. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus made a choice to die for you as the deacons come this morning to serve. Jesus made a choice to give his life for you. He made a choice to sacrifice his flesh for you. His flesh was beaten and battered. It was beating beyond recognition. He made a choice because of his love for you to do that. He made a choice to bleed out for you. To let every drop of blood, I believe it was in his carcass, I believe Jesus died because he bled out. And he offered up the spirit to God. As he was doing that, he said, my God. Because God had turned his face from Jesus. In the middle of the day, when God turned his face from Jesus, darkness fell upon the land. Uncanny that that could happen. Unreal that that could happen. But darkness covered the earth because God turned his face away from Jesus. Why did he do that? Because of the ugliness of our sin that's upon him. Not a sin that he'd committed, but our sins was upon him. He said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? He forsook Jesus in that sinful condition so that he could bear our sins, suffer our sins, and we could come to God through Jesus Christ in moments like these. Jesus made a choice, so you and I can make a choice today, a choice to believe that this bread represents the body of my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that was broken for me. Choose to believe that to take this juice that represents the blood of my blessed Redeemer that was shed for me. Choose to believe that I receive everything he purchased through his body and through his blood. we make a choice. He made a choice to give it. We make a choice to receive it personally for us. If there's nobody else that believed, I had a vision from God. Many of you have heard this vision. There were a multitude, millions of people, just just beyond miles, you could just see the billions of people. And they begin to clear out till all of a sudden it was Jesus and me. And he said, I did this for you. And I want you to know he did it for you. And you and you and you. But he wanted to, because I was thinking about the masses. I'd been studying about the masses of people, billions of people. But he wanted me to know it's personal. And he wants me to serve him personal. So I want to be a leader of you people to serve Christ, but I need to serve him personally. Amen. Irregardless of what you do, I'm going to aim to serve my Lord. Amen. So today, Father, we thank you for this bounty that you've set before us. We believe, according to your word, that this bread is the body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and this juice is the blood. And as we come by faith to believe and receive it, there's a transformation that takes place, and every promise of God becomes yes and amen to each and every one of us that choose to believe. We choose to believe your report today. In Jesus' name, amen. Back in the Old Testament, long before Christ, God put something before the people to believe in the land of plenty. Some believed and some didn't. Those that didn't, he called it an evil report. For those that believed, it is a report of the Lord. Whose report do you believe today? The report of the Lord. Amen. Come and receive. Come and believe.